2 months later, Wes went into the studio to lay down the tracks for his breakthrough recording. Producer Creed Taylor says Wes initially balked at recording an instrumental version of an R&B hit by Little Anthony and the Imperials.
I've never met anybody who was more relaxed and at home in any environment. He just had absolutely no pretension about him as a person. Only time he got a little uptight was when I gave him the Little Anthony and the Imperial 45 record. He says, "You must be out of yours."
Going Out of My Head went gold and earned Wes a Grammy in 1966 for, no small irony here, Best Jazz Performance by a Soloist. Wes's brother Monk was playing in San Francisco when Going Out of My Head came out.
Every time I turned around, I was hearing this Going Out of My Head. We would be driving along in the car, no matter what hour it was, we were hearing Going Out of My Head. I was saying, wow. And I remember I spoke to Wes, it was, man, I don't understand it. It's really, really, that thing is taking off. He just couldn't believe it. I remember when they had set up a tour for him, because now he was really getting it. He came on the West Coast on a tour, and he worked the jazz workshop, and I rushed over to hear Wes at least get there in time for his last set. I couldn't get near the building. They were jammed up outside. I couldn't get near the building, and I was such a delight to stand out there on the sidewalk. They had the door open. You could hear it. It was really a good feeling. It was really a good feeling because he was on his way. There was no question about that. He was really on his way.
The recordings that followed took Wes in an even more commercial direction. Shorter tunes, less improvisation. Some musicians and critics have wondered how a player as original and creative as Wes could have been satisfied playing the pop tunes. One explanation may be Wes's devotion to his family. By this time, he had 7 kids. His widow, Serene, says she stood behind him whatever he wanted to do. She stood by him when he finally quit his day job to devote all of his energies to playing jazz. But she says she also told him he should play music people could have fun with.
I told him, listen, man, if you don't play something that women or the kids can pat their feet and their hands and dance by or something, you're going to starve us to death. You're going to have to play something we like. Because he was playing music that I told him I wouldn't buy it. I said, because I don't understand, what are you doing? Now, blues, yeah, I liked it. I said, why don't you play a pretty blues? You know you can play pretty. He said, you mean to tell me this is what I'm going to have to play? I said, if you're going to feed me and my kids, you're going to have to stop playing the straight jazz. Every once in a while, I play something else. So that's what he did.
And producer Creed Taylor says nobody held a gun to Wes's head to force him to record pop tunes.
My philosophy's always been to put the artist in an environment, a framework that will enable him certainly to be comfortable and perform and sound like himself, but at the same time give him an entree into a wider audience. I've always felt that that was a responsibility.
But Gary Giddins says it was also Taylor's responsibility to ensure that all of Wes's artistry was documented, that he not only had an audience, but that he spoke to listeners with his full voice. Giddins maintains that for every two or three pop records Wes made, he should have been allowed to make a straight-ahead jazz record.
There's a moral here. You know, if you're dealing with a serious artist, you don't know how long you're going to have, and you can't afford, what is it, the last 3 years of his life, or there's virtually no serious documentation of the way he was playing in clubs.
And Wes was playing jazz in clubs and in concert halls up until his death. But there doesn't seem to be any recorded evidence of that after 1965. That year, he toured Europe with a quartet that included pianist Harold Mayburn. Here they are from a BBC TV show called Jazz 625. From college in Iowa to a jazz festival in Kansas City that featured Wes, Nat and Cannonball Adderley, and Clark Terry.
When Wes came out, after Clark played an absolutely stunning set, a whole bunch of us, and a lot of people, believe it or not, started to get up to leave, figuring this is a good time to have lunch, because we just assumed he was going to be playing, you know, a day in the life and these one chorus numbers from the records. Well, I mean, from the first note, everybody just stopped and went back to their seats. He played one of the most dazzling sets I've ever heard anybody play in my life for an hour. He played blues, he played standards, he played chorus on chorus on chorus, like Coltrane. Nobody could believe it. And we figured, oh, well, he must be back. Wait until the next album. But the fact is, he never recorded anything like that again.
Wes Montgomery died shortly after that concert. He had a sudden heart attack on June 15, 1968. He was 45 years old. Maybe the years on the road contributed to Wes Montgomery's untimely death, or the even longer years working multiple jobs to support his family. Maybe it was the stress of performing, the outwardly calm and smiling man who got headaches when he tried to push the bounds of his instrument. And maybe it was a combination of all of these things. Wes Montgomery changed the sound of jazz guitar. He remains one of its most influential practitioners, perhaps the most influential of all time. Yet, he also reached millions more as a sensitive and bluesy interpreter of pop songs. He made all of his records as a leader within the tragically short span of 9 years. Our tribute to Wes Montgomery was written and produced by Tom Cole. We'd like to offer a special thanks to Serene Woods and her husband, Perry.